Hello, aspirants. Welcome to EKS and welcome to the another session of discussion of anthropology. In this session, let us understand about Dryopithecus, which also comes under paper 1, chapter 1.6. In the previous session, we have elaborately discussed about Australopithecine and Homo habilis. In this session, let us understand about Dryopithecus. If you are talking about Dryopithecus, they have originated in Africa and has moved out to other parts of the world and has adapted to diverse environments. The diverse patterns of adaptation has resulted in variations. So in this session, let us elaborately understand about Dryopithecus. In the coming session, we will understand about Ramapithecus and Shivapithecus. Okay, so without much delay, let's start our session, and this is presented by me, Shailaja RAT. In order to understand about Dryopithecus, first we need to understand in which ages they actually dwelt. Okay, in order to understand that, first we need to understand about this Miocene epoch. And if you are talking about Miocene epoch, it falls under Cenozoic era and Tertiary period. In this Tertiary period, Miocene epoch is flanked between Oligocene and Pliocene. Okay, and the literal translation of this Miocene, it is a Greek word which means less recent. And Miocene, just now we have understood that it falls under Oligocene and Pliocene. And Miocene boundaries, what is the importance of Miocene is that in Oligocene there is a warmer climate and Pliocene we have cooler climate. So this is the period which has flanked between this warmer and cooler climate. Okay, and the apes, the importance of this Miocene epoch is that the apes has evolved in this period. In this epoch, they have arose and diversified during the early Miocene. Now let us understand about the Dryopithecus. The literal translation of this Dryopithecus, if you break down this word Dryopithecus, with Dryo which means wood and Pithecus means ape. Whenever you come across this Pithecus, always understand it is referring to ape. Okay, so Dryopithecus is one of the 40 genera representing up to 100 species of the extinct apes that lived in the Miocene epoch, which has flanked between 22.5 to 5.5 million years ago. And Dryopithecus is a common ancestor between ape and man. The fossils of Dryopithecus have been found in the region ranging from Spain to Republic of Georgia. And if you're talking about the spatial distribution, first this Dryopithecus, they have emerged in Kenya, and later they have distributed to France, Spain, Germany, Kenya, India, Hungary, Greece, and etc. So just now we have understood that they have originated in Kenya and later they have spread to other parts. And the kind of environment where they have lived is that they have lived in thick forest where resources are available in plenty. Okay, so Dryopithecus fontani was the first fossil great ape which was discovered, and it was discovered inside Gardens, which is in France, by Edward Lartet in 1856. Okay, now let us understand about the time period of Dryopithecus. Dryopithecus species referred to as Dryopithecines, which has flourished in Europe between 13 to 7 million years ago. About 9 million years ago, the climate became cooler and drier, causing a disappearance of tropical regions in Europe. Many of the Miocene apes became extinct at this time, and Dryopithecus was one of the two lineages, that is Shivapithecus and Ramapithecus, that survived this climate change. So what has happened, there have been built longer bridges between these are the people who has migrated from Africa to later Europe. Okay, so if you consider this to the Africa and this to be the Europe and Asia, assume like this. Okay, from Africa this species has migrated to Europe as well as Asia. So this is their spatial distribution. Okay, so this is very far. So this should be like this. Okay, so this is how they have distributed to other parts of the world, that is the world. And how they have actually distributed, because of the longer bridges, because of the path which they have created, longer bridges has actually developed, and through this they have actually distributed to other parts. And if you're talking about the taxonomy of the Dryopithecus, that is the scientific classification of this Dryopithecus, the kingdom where they belong to, it is Animalia, and the phylum they belong to, it is Chordata, that because they are vertebrates. Okay, and the class they belongs to, it is Mammalia, because they have mammary glands, and because of that they can feed their young ones. And the order, they comes under the order of Primates, and the suborder is a Haplo. This thing you have to understand, Haplorhynchi. And the family where they belong to, it is Hominidae. Hominidae. Okay, they belong to the family Hominidae, and the genus they belong to, it is a Dryopithecus. So this is the taxonomical order of the Dryopithecus. Okay, now let us understand about the physical features of Dryopithecus. Like all living apes, Dryopithecines possess relatively large brains. They also show ape-like characteristics associated with reduced olfactory senses and an increased emphasis on the vision. So what do you mean by this olfactory senses? That is, with the help of sensing capacity, they all actually sense. Okay, but here what has happened? This olfactory senses has decrease, and the vision, that is binocular vision, is actually increasing day by day, and they have shorter snouts. Okay, but what you have to understand is that relative prognathism is actually found even in this species also, and the forward-facing eye sockets with overlapping fields of vision. Okay, and supraorbital ridges are still prominent in this and Dryopithecus, because more or less they actually resemble to the ape. Like all living apes, Dryopithecines also lack tail. The skeletal remains indicate that Dryopithecines were quadrupeds walking on four legs, and they have adapted to this brachiation. What do you mean by brachiation? From one tree to another tree, they usually jump. So finally, in the features, we can conclude that it is a combination of monkeys, apes, and mans, and has displayed characteristics which include small skull, narrow face, smaller brain, hand bones, which are similar to those of monkeys. Okay, now let us understand about the prehensile nature of Dryopithecus. Just now we have understood that they have adopted this to this brachiation. That is brachiation, it is like jumping from one tree to another. But if at this, what is the important thing? They have adapted to this prehensile nature. They possess adaptations to the suspensory locomotion. The stable yet fully extendable elbow joint allowed them to hang and swing below branches. In addition, the remains of the hands and feet show that they possessed powerful grasping capabilities. All of these characteristics suggest that Dryopithecus moved about the forest canopy in a way that a similar modern great apes has actually dwelt. Here, what we have to understand is that there is a thick canopy, that is, there are very thick forests. Because of that reason, it is very simple for them to jump from one tree to another. That is, they are highly arboreal in nature, but the next species, that is, while discussing about Ramapithecus and Shivapithecus, they have adopted both to this arboreal and the terrestrial kind of living. Okay, but if you're talking about the Dryopithecus, they more or less, we can say that they are mostly arboreal in nature, and they have this prehensile capabilities, that is, hanging, the freely suspension to the branches is called as prehensile nature. Now let us understand about their dental arcade. The lower molar teeth of a Dryopithecus have long had significance for the paleoanthropologists. Their five cusps are arranged in a pattern that is observed in fossils and recent apes as well as humans. It is known as the Y5 pattern. So this is called as Wi-Fi pattern. In this, if you observe carefully, in this pattern, the three cups, namely 1, 3, 5, that is 1, 3 and 5, they are placed on the cheek side, and 2 and 4 cups are placed on the tongue side. Okay, so this is usually called as a Wi-Fi cusp pattern. And if you're talking about this molar, first you need to understand is that ICPM, this is how our dental arcade is actually located: incisors, canines, premolars and premolars. Okay, So here it is known that it is known as the Wi-Fi pattern because this fish is separating the five cusps from a Y. This is one of the main characteristics that are used to distinguish apes from monkeys. Okay, and the size and shape of the other teeth, including large incisors and blade-like canine teeth, suggest that Dryopithecus were adapted to a diet of soft and ripe fruits. Which means that Dryopithecus are frugivore. What do you mean by frugivore? That is, those who ate fruits are called as frugivores. Okay, so Dryopithecus are frugivores, and the evidence, how we got this evidence is this, because in on the cavities of the teeth, it indicates that a high sugar diet is deriving from ripe fruits and honey. Dryopithecus likely had a high carbohydrate and low fiber diet, and the aspect of the skeleton that reflect the history variables including tooth microstructure and brain size suggest similarities to living apes. Dryopithecines apparently lived relatively long lives, matured relatively slowly, and gave birth to one large offspring at a time. It is commonly estimated that the living weight of a male Dryopithecus was estimated around 44 kgs. And the place of Dryopithecus in human and ape evolution is still debated. The recent discovery in 1999 of a new Dryopithecus skull from Hungary shows that the cranium is more similar to that of African apes and early fossil humans than to the Asian apes. Thus, scientists suggest that Dryopithecus or its close relative Oronopithecus was the likely ancestor of African apes and humans. In this were the case, the common ancestor of African apes and humans would have originated in Eurasia and has later migrated to Africa to establish separate African ape and human lineages sometime during the late Miocene. Okay? So if you are talking about the relationship of Dryopithecus and Shivapithecus, Shivapithecus and Proconsul, so this is not important with respect to the examination point of view, but Shivapithecus and Ramapithecus, these are very very important for us. Okay, they were the ancestral to the orangutan and chimpanzee and gorilla and resemble gibbon in stature. Most of the fossils are represented by the jaw fragments and teeth, with few exceptions such as humerus and ulna from the France and femur from Germany. Okay, the three genera Dryopithecus, Shivapithecus and Proconsul have been placed in the subfamily Dryopithecae, and arms and legs were of the same length and posture was semi-erect, and skull lacked the well-developed crest and massive ridges characteristics of modern apes. So dental arc was parabolic and dentition more man-like, but canines were larger and lower molar is sectorial. It was a brachiator swinging with arms on the tree branches. So in late Miocene, a drying trend in Europe has caused the replacement of forest land and woodland by open shrubland, and because of the upliftment of the Alps caused tropical and warmer climate vegetation in the central Europe to retreat in favor of mid-latitude and alpine flora. Probably this must be the reason for the extinction of greater apes in Europe. Okay, by this I am actually winding up the session, guys. If you appreciate our work, do like, share and subscribe, hit the bell icon so that you won't miss any of the videos which we are uploading. Okay, and in next session we will understand about Ramapithecus and Shivapithecus. That's all for the day. Meet you in another session. Bye bye.